why it takes me back to the future like Dorian Wilkes and Michael J. Fox with Parkinson's. Panama Black, here to do what he do best.
What's up, people? This is Axiom for the Grounded TV Network. And we're here with Ohmega Watts. How you doing today, man?
Doing pretty good. Nice sunny day in Van. Looking good, feeling good.
That's right. So I think our main question is, our main topic of focus is going to be about production today, because you are a master behind the boards. And why don't you tell us a little bit about how you go about making beats in the first place?
Okay. So it takes different forms, but for the most part, like, I grew up as just classic hip-hop head. Born in 79, you know, so I came up in the mid-80s hearing, you know, seeing Beat Street, seeing these movies and different things. And, the sound for me was always influenced from the older records. So as I got into digging and producing at about 17, 18, records have always been a staple that I'll pull from, but I also have, like, little keyboards, you know, synthesizers. I got a Moog, or a Moog, as you would say, Rhodes. So I incorporate everything from sampling bits, and I have an MPC, an old 2000 and a 2500. So I sample, you know, live drum pieces and breaks, mix it all up with samples, drop everything from my MPC and the Pro Tools, and then just go to, you know, just pretty much go to work with whatever my mind's thinking.
It's the folk doctor, who that? Well, why's proper rock in Philadelphia with the root K-L-Y-N? Native MCIB, 6'1 height, chocolate brown, 10 and West Indian, your brother, let's get in it. It's up by using your senses.
I would say for what people really know me for, coming out on Ubiquity and putting out my two solo albums from 05 to 07 with the last record.
Which are?
What's Happening was the last, and The Find was my first solo record on Ubiquity Records. And knowing that we couldn't clear certain samples, like, I had to really be ingenuitive in, okay, I have this, how can I chop this up and completely make it sound different, but then what can I do more to add to it to make it still feel full, almost like it's all sampled, you know? So I'd work with musicians, and I'd play anything I can on my own, you know, from synths to my Rhodes or whatever, any random percussion sounds, and add to it. So it's a happy medium between both. But then there's certain tracks where people would think that I might have played somewhere. I'm like, no, well, that's all samples. It's just the way I did it, you know. I definitely got away with chopping up individual parts from a couple different places and rearranging them that you definitely couldn't tell where they came from.
All right, so there's a lot of artists like The Lifesavers, Vitamin D, Jake One, a lot of cats out of that part of the world that have, like, you know, had a heavy influence from the golden age of hip-hop and all that. What do you have to say about, you know, just the direction that hip-hop's going right now?
Yeah. It's crazy because I think just with the influx of technology with YouTube and a lot of other, like, sites, people are able to learn and pick up anything you want. And also with the just advancement in home studios and recording, there's so much coming out that the hip-hop pot is ridiculously saturated. So there's good and bad that comes out of that, because, as you were saying, there's, like, in the Northwest, there's been, from Van and even, you know, down to the Bay, but more so keeping it strictly Northwest, as Portland up to Van, it's like you have a lot of producers and MCs that are somewhat, you know, keeping the love of what they know they grew up on, that are at least in the age range of 20s up to their 30s. You know, I just turned 30 this year, and anyone that's within that bracket, whether 5 or so years younger than me or ahead of me, that I think as the producers that you name, like Jake One, Lifesavers, Vitamin D, and their influences, I feel they're trying to keep that alive but still stay progressive with where things have went. With other influencers that came out, like after the Pete Rock and Premiere, you had like Dilla, and then you have Madlib, and then you have some other people who've advanced it in another way to still keep that purest form.
It's like recreating the same thing, but like trying to make it something new every time, right?
Exactly. You know, like putting a new spin on it, because being DJs and producers, like, we listen to a lot of things. So I know, which all of them are, everyone that I named and that you named, you know, they're all DJ producers as well. So with record digging and collecting, like, there's so many influences to draw from. And I think in the Northwest, there's been a lot of people trying to, like, infuse different rhythms or sounds, but still come from that organic state of, all right, I started with a sample, but now what can I do with it?
There's something to be said about the content of most of your music when you're actually, when you're emceeing on your own beats and when you're appearing on other people's shit.
Yeah.
It's like there's this element of, because you're a producer, you're it's like, that's a throwback thing to be referencing the production and talking about what you're living, right?
Yeah.
How do you feel that music like that can take the focus off of maybe whatever negative shit that people put out, and what do you think should be put into content when people are writing their lyrics, when they're trying to, you know, get their voice heard?
I think in any and everything, it's like, I'm definitely, in all that I write and do, I'm spiritually driven and morally driven. So it's like, I feel, for me, it's like, there's certain things in society, wherever you're at, that are acceptable. There's like things you wouldn't say around kids where some people don't care. So you have all these kids supporting your music, but you're telling them about money, sex, drugs, this, that, you know, and like glorifying these things that end up crippling people, especially in third world countries, you know, people in Africa and other areas in Calcutta or in, you know, wherever around the world, in Brazil, rocking like 50 cent shirts, you know, ride or die from different whatevers. And it's like, they don't even have money and they're fighting for this like lifestyle that really is gonna negatively impact them and already is, you know? So I feel if you're an MC or a singer, whatever you do, speak what's true to your heart and your life. But I feel we should try to implement some type of positive message and change. But I mean, you know, if you're pissed, say it. Say what you say. You know, I'm not about trying to censor someone from what they feel, being the artist they are. But I think take into account the effects and repercussions of it worldwide. So if you want to make money at it and you're going to be a show clown, fine. Do what you do. That's your thing. But if anyone's just going to be true, I just say, really, bottom line is, be true to who you are.
Omega Watts.
Grounded.
Yes,
right. Axiom.
This music from extinction. Addiction. Brooklyn to the core. Born and raised in the Ryan Apple. So I keep it raw and perpendicular. Symmetrical with every line. Solid structure. So easy to follow my rhymes. Take your time. Life's fast. Pace enough already. When you rock, keep it steady. Word to crazy legs and Eddie. Got the rock bottom prices. Everything's free on the menu. At your local venue. With the small fee to see what we do. All right, okay. Grab a hold of your peers. Spread the word. Letting them know that we were raw for years. So when we're rocking shows, you watch us with your eyes. Digest the lyrics, you hear it with your ears. When it's all live, you stand and raise your hands. Then you get down to the ground.